previously, we focused on the Bohr effect, and we said the Bohr effect tells us that the concentration of carbon dioxide and H plus ions in the blood affects hemoglobin's affinity for oxygen. And what the Bohr effect ultimately does is it increases the amount of oxygen that can be absorbed by the exercising tissue, and it also increases the amount of oxygen that can be absorbed by the blood from the alveoli of our lungs. Now, another equally important effect is known as the Haldane effect. And the Haldane effect is really the opposite, the reverse of the Bohr effect. So remember, the Bohr effect talks about how the concentration of CO2 and hydrogen affects hemoglobin's affinity for oxygen. But what the Haldane effect does is it takes the opposite perspective. It talks about how the concentration of oxygen inside the red blood cell, inside our blood, actually affects hemoglobin's affinity for carbon dioxide and H plus ions. Now, why is the Haldane effect actually important? Well, as we'll see in just a moment, the Haldane effect actually promotes, it increases the amount of carbon dioxide that can be released by the exercising tissue to the blood. And at the same time, it also increases the number of CO2 molecules that can be absorbed by the alveoli of the lungs from the blood plasma. And to see what the Haldane effect is and how it achieves this, let's begin by taking a look at the following diagram. So let's suppose I'm moving my arm back and forth. And as I move my arm back and forth, the muscle tissue begins to contract and ATP molecules are being produced by those muscle cells. So this is, let's suppose, that muscle cell, and this is the nearby capillary that carries the red blood cells. Now, as these cells are exercising, they require a greater number of oxygen molecules to produce the ATP. And so inside the red blood cells, the Bohr effect takes place that causes hemoglobin to actually unload and release the oxygen, which then travels into those exercising cells. Inside the cells, in a process called aerobic cellular respiration, we produce the energy ATP molecules. Now, these ATP molecules are used for muscle contraction, for the actin contraction, but the CO2 molecules, a byproduct, are produced, and these cannot be used in any useful way. And so the CO2 molecules are expelled from the cell, and they enter the blood plasma of the capillary, the nearby capillary. Now, because carbon dioxide is nonpolar, only a very small portion, about 5%, will actually remain dissolved in the blood plasma. The majority of it, the rest of it, will enter the cytoplasm of the red blood cell. Now, once inside the red blood cell, what we have to do is we have to convert the carbon dioxide, a nonpolar molecule, into a polar form, namely the bicarbonate. And that's because we want to be able to dissolve the carbon dioxide in the blood. So the majority of the carbon dioxide in the red blood cell will follow this reaction pathway. So a special enzyme we call carbonic anhydrase will combine carbon dioxide and water to form the carbonic acid molecule. And then the carbonic acid, being a good acid, it will dissociate into H plus ions and the bicarbonate ions. And this is where the Haldane effect takes place. So according to the Haldane effect, if we decrease the concentration of oxygen in the red blood cell, so the amount of oxygen decreases because it travels into the tissue, that exercising tissue. And so as this basically decreases, that increases the affinity of hemoglobin for the H plus ions. Now, if we increase hemoglobin's affinity for H plus ions, what that means is the hemoglobin will begin to bind the H plus ions. And so the concentration of these free H plus ions will begin to decrease because they will begin to bind to the hemoglobin. Now, what will happen as we decrease this H plus concentration? Well, by Le Chatelier's principle, if we decrease the product concentration, that will shift the equilibrium toward the right side, toward the product side. And what that means is, as hemoglobin is binding H plus ions, we're going to ultimately produce even more of the bicarbonate ions. And it's these bicarbonate ions that are basically the polar form of these CO2 molecules. And so ultimately, the Haldane effect basically increases the number of bicarbonate ions that we can store and dissolve in the blood plasma next to the exercising tissue. So once again, the Haldane effect, the fact that as we decrease the concentration of oxygen inside the red blood cell as it leaves and enters our tissue cell, that increases hemoglobin's affinity to bind H plus ions. So this is what the Haldane effect tells us. And what the Haldane effect does is it basically shifts the equilibrium to the right side towards the bicarbonate side, and that increases the number of CO2 molecules in this form that we can store and dissolve in the blood plasma of the nearby capillary. Now, we can also represent this effect graphically. So let's take a look at the following graph. The y-axis is basically the CO2 content in the blood, dissolved in the blood. And the x-axis is the partial pressure of the carbon dioxide in that region in the blood. Now, this relatively straight line, the black curve, basically describes how much carbon dioxide we can dissolve inside the blood at some given partial pressure of carbon dioxide. And notice, as we decrease the concentration of oxygen inside the red blood cell, the Haldane effect basically causes a leftward shift in this curve. And so the curve moves into the blue position. Now, why is that? Well, let's suppose that this is the partial pressure of carbon dioxide inside the exercising tissue. And so we draw a straight line going upward. Now, in this particular case, this line basically did not take into consideration the Haldane effect. And according to this line, we can only fit this amount of CO2 inside our blood. But if we do take the Haldane effect into consideration, because we do decrease the oxygen content in our blood next to the exercising tissue, that shifts the curve this way to the left. And so the new y coordinate is this value here. And notice that what that means is, as the oxygen decreases, we can actually store even more carbon dioxide inside our blood because of what we discussed just a moment ago. So we see that a drop in the oxygen in the red blood cells next to the exercising tissue actually causes a leftward shift in the curve, which means more carbon dioxide can ultimately be stored inside the blood. And so the tissues will release more of the carbon dioxide because we can fit more of it into that blood plasma. Now, we can also use the Haldane effect to basically describe how the alveoli of the lungs are able to absorb more carbon dioxide from the blood plasma. So the Haldane effect can also be used to explain how oxygen concentration affects carbon dioxide unloading into the alveoli of the lung. So let's take a look at the following diagram. So as always, we have the red blood cell, and this is the alveolus of our lung. Now, what's happening inside our lungs? Well, inside our lungs, the oxygen is moving down its concentration gradient from the alveolus and into the red blood cell. Now, by the Haldane effect, so again, we have this Haldane effect taking place. And by this Haldane effect, because we increase the concentration of oxygen inside our red blood cell, we decrease hemoglobin's ability to bind carbon dioxide and H plus ions. So as O2 binds to hemoglobin, it basically decreases hemoglobin's affinity for H plus and CO2. So these two molecules are now released. Now, as we release carbon dioxide, the carbon dioxide will begin to dissolve and eventually will leave the red blood cell and into the alveolus. Now, the hemoglobin also releases the H plus ions, which bind onto the hemoglobin in this area. What happens to the H plus ions is they essentially recombine with the bicarbonate ions that came from the blood plasma. Remember, these bicarbonate ions dissolve into the blood plasma. At the same time, we have the the chloride ions going into the red blood cell. That's known as the chloride shift. And in here, the opposite takes place. These basically move into the cell, chloride ions leave the cell, and this recombines with the H plus to reform the carbonic acid, and then that basically breaks down into carbon dioxide, and the carbon dioxide then leaves the cell and it enters the alveolus. And so we see that the Haldane effect basically promotes the amount of CO2 that can be absorbed by the alveolus. So the red blood cells near the lungs filled with oxygen. The rise in oxygen causes them to bind to hemoglobin, which in turn decreases hemoglobin's affinity for carbon dioxide and H plus ions. And this stimulates the unloading of CO2 and H plus ions from the hemoglobin and eventually from the lungs, and it enters the alveolus, and then we expel it in the process of exhalation. Now, we can also look at this graphically, but now we're going to see a rightward shift and not a leftward shift. So once again, the y-axis is the content of CO2 in the blood, the x-axis is the partial pressure of that CO2, and now the partial pressure of CO2 will be smaller than in this case, so we're going to be farther to the left side along the curve, because in the lungs, we have a lower CO2 concentration than in the tissues. And so now we're somewhere here. Now, an increase in the oxygen content in our red blood cell next to the lungs means we have a rightward shift in our curve. So the black curve now shifts this way. And what that means is, before, this is how much CO2 was actually stored in the blood, but now this is how much CO2 can be stored in the blood. So we have less CO2 that can be stored and dissolved in the blood. Now, if we can dissolve CO2 in the blood, where can the CO2 go? Well, the only place it can actually go is into the alveoli of the lungs. And that's exactly what happens. As it moves into the alveoli, we have the pressure difference that expels that CO2 to the outside environment. And this is what the Haldane effect is. The Haldane effect promotes the release of CO2 from the tissue to the blood, and also promotes the release of CO2 from the blood and to the alveoli of the lungs.